It's not too late to run.
No,
that was last hour. They had a nice time. They're one of the reasons the building was open, so we appreciate that. So in a little bit here, I'm going to kick off an argumentative presentation about information security careers that will hopefully get everybody laughing and talking and get some good exchange going. But first off, some administrative. This is manuals. If it's a little different than the spot we've been using for, I don't know, centuries? Somebody was trying to figure it out back there. We get along with them really, really well. They invited us back before they're even done with their renovations because we have such a great relationship with them. And it's based on a couple of key principles, which I will outline now. Tip like crazy. When Taylor used to give this rant, he would say, tip like you think you have a shot with your server. If that makes you tip more, then do that. Whichever heuristic leads to more gratuity. And she just told me her name, and I've already said it.
Laura,
yes. Laura's already been taking great care of us here and has put up with me for at least an hour now. So make sure to take care of her and the place. Along with that, when she comes in with food or beer, she might have to call out people's names or like work her way back to get you all your stuff. That's my cue to shut up. If you're talking, it's your cue to shut up. The beer and the food take precedence over whatever other nonsense it is that we're doing here this afternoon. So tip like crazy, don't get in the way of the beer. Sound good?
Yeah, right.
It's a good place for beer. If you don't know, DC404 is the Atlanta chapter of the DEF CON. What the hell is DEF CON? Probabilistic cloud of hacker presence.
It's a party.
It's a party with good security talks. At least that's what it was when I was out there. DEF CON is the world's biggest hacker convention. It's in Vegas in the summer. They usually pick the hottest week of the year, from what I can tell. It's a great show if you haven't been. But part of DEF CON's effect on the world is the local chapters. And that chapter is actually pretty cool. We've even won some awards, though I don't know if anyone ever received them. That's a funny story for later. We have a website, which has actually been updated recently and is now pretty accurate and cool. We have a sister chapter in DC 770. 770, are you here? I don't see anybody, but I'm bad with faces. Okay. Who have just gotten started just a few months ago, but who are going strong. Both our meeting announcements and their meeting announcements and 2600's meeting announcements and all kinds of other great stuff go to the mailing list, which if you're not on, you should get on it. If you don't know what a mailing list is, ask someone for help. It may sound like antiquated technology, but they're actually pretty helpful. Whew. Today's presentation is also by me. Keith, who ordinarily MCs these sorts of things, is unfortunately homesick. So our best wishes to Keith, and I hope he feels better. Apparently he eats oatmeal. Didn't really understand that email, but I was reading it on my phone. Nobody? Okay. Probably for the best. This is actually a reprise or a second version of a talk that I gave at DC404 a couple years ago. And I think the theme is even stronger than it was now, which that is that a lot of people in educational communities, a lot of people in DC404, whether it's the meetings or the mailing lists or random people dropping into the IRC channel, are really interested in getting into careers in information security. Or they say things that when you translate them, that might be what they could mean, you know, like people who want to be a hacker, even though they're not really sure what any of those words mean. And as more and more good and bad TV shows and movies are produced, and more as information security stuff becomes real news and real world effects for everybody, this is just going to continue. But rather than this being a talk about how to learn how to pen test a thing or how to learn how to forensicate a thing, to get the red team and the blue team in here, this is more on the slightly fuzzier side. This is a whole mess of kind of career tips, but the central point is that we can all do a lot better at looking for jobs, and especially at job interviews. The provocation for this presentation in the first place was pretty much a solid year spent at SecureWorks trying to fill out people for our incident response team. Trying to get analysts, trying to get responders, trying to find a malware guy. And fed into that was my other years of trying to hire sysadmins, trying to hire netadmins, and occasionally actually trying to get those jobs myself. So I've been on both sides of the table, and I've seen it screwed up from both sides. So this is my hope to help out a little bit, and also just to get the discussion started. Oh, come on, clicky thing. So, second title, a little more accurate. How we can both get more out of your next job interview. Please be a little bit more prepared for all of our sakes. Whether you are the, theoretical newbie trying to break into the field, trying to get their first security job, or you've been around the block a couple of times, you're moving to another team or to another firm, I think the tips apply pretty well in either situation. You just kind of have to work it out. Some disclaimers and a little bit of the background that I've already gone into. I am not a manager at my day job. I generally say thankfully after that. I have been a team lead a couple of times. I might be one now. There's some discussion on that subject. I'm not recruiting or hiring today, though our team is, and I'm going to touch on that after the presentation. For good measure, I am not a licensed counselor or therapist. I am not a lawyer, yours, mine, or anyone else's, and I'm definitely not in law enforcement, just in case anybody was asking. And like I said, this kind of started off with a lot of bad interviews, some of which directly came from people on the DC404 list. Please don't raise your hands. They're not here. Well, I'm here, but the rest, yeah. This is me, actually in my third full-time information security job. After working in IT for a bunch of years, I finally was able to switch over and do security full-time, which is pretty great. I was a sysadmin, I've been an incident responder, I'm an intrusion analyst. Sometimes I forensicate things, but I try not to use that word because it gets people excited. And besides the day job, which is a really, really big business based out of Atlanta, does anybody know where I work? Somebody, I shout it out, it's just not in the slides.
What, Secure?
Before that, sorry, I did work at Secure Labs. Way to pay attention. So, brownie points there. My day job right now is at the Home Depot, which I think you've all heard of. We're a pretty big company. You're for DC404?
Yes.
Awesome. Yep. Okay. I see wherever you can.
Okay.
And besides that day job at that wonderful and challenging corporation here in Atlanta, I also teach for the SANS Institute part-time as a community instructor. If you don't know about SANS, we are the most awesome and most expensive security training resource on Earth. Absolutely the best courses in almost every topic you can think of. Pretty pricey. Worth every penny, I will certainly argue, but definitely the most expensive stuff. I will be teaching Security Essentials next week in Seattle. And then I've got a November class of Sec 511, Security Operations and Continuous Monitoring here in Atlanta, which if I haven't already posted about it to the list, I will again soon. There are a couple of other SANS instructors in the DC404 community, so Brian, I believe, is trying to put together a class for intrusion analysis for 503, and Joe is working up a class for 504. So if you have interest, or more importantly, budget for SANS training for the rest of the year, check those out. So, to start off with some facts, are there actually any jobs available in information security? There are all these people clamoring for them, they seem to have trouble getting them. I mean, it's enough for somebody to actually even have a whole presentation about how to get a job. I mean, there's no assembly code, I swear, in this presentation. There are definitely jobs. There are almost no entry-level security jobs. And in fact, as we were talking about before we got started this afternoon, from a certain perspective, there shouldn't be. this is the argument, which we can get into a little bit later if you want, towards the end of the deck, about degrees and majors and stuff like that. Almost all of the InfoSec jobs, especially the ones that are easy to find, do probably require some IT or technical experience or skills to get in the door. That's not universally true. There are plenty of jobs in information security as a field or the information security department or divisions of a lot of big companies that are not technical in the way that hackers ordinarily might think of it, but that are incredibly vital. Social engineering is actually more effectively done by people with psych degrees than by people who know how to work computers, because they know how to program humans. It's cool, it's pretty scary. lawyers are vital. They actually know how to work the code of the law, which if you think that's not important, yeah, you're just wrong. And I'm not gonna try and explain it to you right now, but please don't speed. I don't wanna switch topics into don't talk to the police, but if you haven't watched that video, somebody could probably throw out a link. And of course, law enforcement. A lot of people work in law enforcement, do InfoSec work, prosecute, that is the correct word, some of the most awful things that people do with computers, and they're not necessarily of a very technical background, but they still stop bad guys. And they're definitely still part of our community. We help each other out a lot. And the next point beyond are there jobs is, do you want to try and get an existing job? Do you want to go and find a job that's listed at some company and say, I want to be that thing level two. Yeah, that's me. And put your cover letter together and send in a resume and go at it that way. I mean, that's definitely an option. It does work well in some situations. But another idea entirely is to find an organization that has a need and to kind of wedge yourself into it. Politely and professionally, of course, but if you can demonstrate to them that you can bring something that they didn't even know they're missing and do it in a compelling way, that's a really great way to get the job that you want. Josh Moore, excuse me, goes on about that a fair bit in his awesome job reconnaissance book. And finally, kind of knowing where you're at and what you're looking for is going to be a big theme all the way through this, but for the first phase of that, are you looking for a career or trying to become an InfoSec professional, or do you just need a job? The non-trivial differences between these things, especially if you're beyond your first hop and you're trying to go to your second or your third hop, knowing where you're going and what your focuses are, incredibly important. In the factoid section, summarized as words, they mean stuff, which is a great quote from a cert manager I used to work for. Without going into any detail about what any of this stuff means right now, understand that there is terminology, and occasionally even jargon, used by people who work in InfoSec that you will need to understand. And unfortunately, there are some trigger words that you should either not use or understand that they are gonna cause reactions in people. One of those is the C word. I need to get closer to my glass.
C word.
Always trying to explain that to this guy.
I don't know who this guy is.
You.
Are you gonna explain all your acronyms?
No. That's kind of the point. That there are a lot of acronyms, and sometimes they're used differently by different people for different things, even before you get into government space. But there's some pretty big important words up here that I am gonna touch on briefly. And the first one is the C word. So, if you use the word cyber, taking a drink, with anybody under the age of, I don't know, 30, 40, anybody who's been on the internet more than 5 years, I'm not really sure where to draw the lines, but with a large swath of the population, you might be thinking like, information warfare, or the government will buy this, and you're probably right. But what you're saying is, I want to have sex online with you. So be careful who you make that offer to. A lot of very, very otherwise serious and extremely well-funded programs, not just limited to the government, though they are strongly guilty, use the C word a lot. It sounds cool. Sometimes it's actually even the right word to use. And I am happy to be wrong about this, and was had a different opinion on it 5 or 10 years ago. Even if it's the correct technical term, even if it exactly describes what you're talking about, you should understand that when you use that word in a sentence, when you use it as an adjective and you start slamming it onto things, it's going to have a reaction to people. And the reaction that you're mostly going to get from using cyber isn't actually the one that I mentioned about online sex. That's just the joke. Though you will get that from some of us who are old enough or who were really bored when we were younger. The real trouble is it just makes it sound like you don't know what you're talking about, because most of the people who are using that word don't. Hey, look, no argument. That's a hint right there.
If I'm small, the women are not going to have a problem with that.
Sorry?
If I use cyber, they're not getting together with it.
That might cause a different problem. And the other word, which is particularly important since we're here at a hackers meeting, it's a hackers group, hope you knew that before you walked past the curtain, is actually the word hacker, or even to hack. This has a pretty clear and frankly awesome meaning to people who work in computer engineering or information security, or who did model trains at MIT in the middle of the 20th century. Nothing? That's actually where the modern usage of the word came from. When you use that word, it's going to resonate with people, and maybe not in the way that you want. So my shortcut here is I pretty much always use the word attacker. And in fact, you'll even see me do it transparently. When I'm reading stuff by otherwise intelligent and interesting people, including possibly some of my course material, and they say, and then the hacker will steal your password, I will say out loud, then the attacker will steal your password. This is a little bit more accurate and less politically charged. Come on in. You can go with Sime and Huke, which is a Japanese martial arts thing from, I think, judo and aikido, where it's not so much who's attacking and who's defending, because that can be hard to figure out. It doesn't usually matter. It's simply who initiates the action and who receives it. And if you get into network analysis at all and stimulus and response, this will become more and more clear. Hey, more people. Yay. So knowing what words mean, to quote Ken again, is actually really important. And since we're focused a lot on the interview process, this is incredibly critical. Here are some things that I think that you have to win at this game at any level. You need to be able to communicate well, and probably through multiple media. You need to be able to communicate well on the phone. Chances are we're not going to fly you in for a level one interview unless we're already really interested in you as a candidate, or you're working some other angle. You absolutely have to be able to communicate well in email, as well as in synchronous communication methods like chat. Just because it's synchronous, and maybe even just because the vendor told you that it was ephemeral, well, one, that's not true. And two, you're always trying to project professionalism, especially when you're trying to get money from people, right? Whatever it is you currently do, you need to know how you're awesome at it, so that you understand that in your mind, and so that you can project that. You're not necessarily going to want to try and tell someone that in an interview or in a cover letter, but you need to feel it and kind of have a hold of it so that you can project the right ideas and the right energy. You need to have a resume or a CV with no lies in it. I'm going to hit on this point a lot. Not kidding.
Why'd you look at me?
I didn't yet, but I might next. It doesn't necessarily have to have a lot of awesome stuff in it, but it really needs to not have any lies. Especially lies that can be trivially disproven by a quick Google search. I'm not looking at anybody in particular, nobody here in the room, I'm just saying. At least if you're going to try and fabricate things on your resume, if you're going to give me the resume of one of your cover identities, put a little work into it. Come on, show some respect. And not lying. Not just on the resume, but in any other communication involved with a business relationship, especially trying to get a job from somebody. Because the number one thing that I will flunk you out of an interview process no matter how awesome a candidate you are for is if you lie to us about anything. Especially trying to get a job as a hacker, there's a lot of stuff we can let slide. Even at really big companies, if you think you have something in your background that you want to conceal from us, I don't recommend it. You may not want to put it on the application that goes in the web page, that goes into the database, but when you're actually talking to a hiring manager, you need to share stuff like that rather than lie about it. Because we are going to find out. And with every company I've ever worked for or read paperwork for, if you lie during the interview process, and we ever find out, no matter how many years it's been, and how long you've worked for us, you are immediately fired with prejudice in states where that's legal. No lying. So I said we're mostly going to talk about the interview process because that was the impetus for this series of rants collected with clip art into open office slides. Or sorry, Libre Office. Are we going with Libre because we're in Western Hemisphere?
They're saying they're finally shutting the doors on open office.
They're talking about it. We'll see how it goes.
Only the text. Read the text.
So here are some questions to be prepared for. Sorry. In a much bigger crowd, which is awesome than we did when I first started walking around up here. And as we all recall, food and beverage more important than my yammering.
Long-term needs versus short-term needs.
So here are some of the basic questions that we are definitely going to ask. You might even get hit with these on like a form that you have to fill out before you even have a chance for a phone screen. As we go through all these questions, some of them seem kind of simple, some of them are kind of hard. You need to know your own answers to these questions. Again, kind of like the awesome thing, you're not necessarily going to give these answers, but you've got to have them so that you can respond the right way to these questions. And of course, I don't necessarily tell you the questions that we ask in the slides because that would be a spoiler, and that's no fun. Some of the basic questions are, you know, why are you trying to get into security, especially if it is your first security job? You know, why this particular specialty or this position? And of course, why you, why us, and then whatever managers ask. I'm never on those calls because I'm not a manager. So. Answers for why security? Oh good, those are still funny. Whatever your reasons are, even if they're dumb, you need to understand them. Again, you're not necessarily going to share them if they're dumb or involve CSI. Especially the other one that I'm not even, no. That's pretty bad, but no, somebody told me that they made another CSI show after
CSI
the one.
CSI.
Why are you all so willing to say that?
They made more than one.
There's like three or four of them now.
The Matrix.
I am Superman.
Ouch. Or should I say, whoa. Whatever your reason is to try and get into security, you need to know what that is and be able to talk about it. So this goes back to being able to communicate well. Sometimes that's a place to start. But we talked about that word. Here's some silly stuff. But this is about half true, right? If you are already in a specialty and you're just trying to get a job in it, that can help. We're going to talk a little bit more about like having an online presence and a portfolio, but that's another thing that's key here. Oh, good. Those are still funny, too.
Forensic major.
This is a running joke throughout all the slides. I'll ask at the end if anybody's figured it out. But whatever your reason is for the specific position, and if you are applying to a position listing, you need to actually think about this for a second, even if it sounds kind of silly. I mean, you probably don't actually want to be like help desk monkey level zero, but you do kind of have to be able to say that you do, or you're not going to get past the gate, right? Think of it as ice, if that helps. And as I touched on, you need to know enough about yourself and where you are and where you're going to be able to sell yourself. So, you know, of course, how you're awesome, what you've already done, the contributions you've already made in the field or in the community, if you've got that. Anything from your other jobs that will make you good at this job that you're applying for. Everything from, you know, your time in food service helped you understand customer service. If it's not BS, that can help you. If it is BS, then you're lying and we know what happens. How are you going to help this organization? Whether it's the team that you're hiring onto, but beyond that, the whole company, depending on the size of it, can be significant. And this is another place where researching the org, if we haven't already beaten on that enough, incredibly important, especially beyond that first hop. I mean, intro-level positions, you're going to have to apply a lot of places to get in. That's just the reality. It's just probability and combinatorics. But when you're trying to make that second hop, or when you are trying to go full-time, when you've been working part-time in security and part-time in IT, understanding the organization that you're trying to get into, what their needs are, and how you can help, very, very key. And again, whatever you can sell. And you need to know why you're trying to get in with that company, or that team, or that location. And again, even if it's not the answer that you're going to share with a hiring manager, you need to know what it is. Yeah, all of that is true of some people I know. Not all the same person at the same time, or so I'm saying now. When you are no longer a young, single, immortal, healthy person, benefits rather than just cash becomes something you have to think about. Another thing about compensation besides just money, I'm going to plug Sands again. See that? Ever see that? It's incredibly expensive. You don't want to pay for that stuff yourself. As you're looking for places to work, and as you're talking about compensation, and as you're thinking about what kind of compensation you need to be comfortable with, think about stuff like that. I mean, flat out, if you're talking salary with somebody and they can't guarantee that they have a training budget to cover your educational expenses for the year, bump up your salary request. The appropriate number of tens of thousands of dollars, as the case may be, right? I mean, this is not chump change anymore. And similarly, something like health insurance or library access, that doesn't exactly sell it. Access to online courseware and MOOCs and possibly an online graduate program, that can be incredibly valuable to you if it is, and that might be more useful to you than a few thousand bucks extra. So understand where your flexibility is and what's important to you. I mean, we all want and need money, of course, but if there's some other stuff that the organization can give you, that might help you figure out where you need to be. And as you start to network, you know how I haven't said that before, with other people who work at some of these companies, you can find out more information about this stuff, right? This isn't necessarily going to be public information, like whether or not they actually pay for training, whether you get to go to DEF CON. You know, they can't usually publish stuff like that on the website. Their lawyers would get really mad if they did. Because when you make promises in writing, apparently it's binding.
Yeah, that's all legal side.
Yeah.
Yay for lawyers.
Whatever you do put on that resume is fair game. You're probably going to be uploading it into some kind of horrible computer system that's going to chew it up and just pull out the keywords. But later on, if you actually make it to a second round interview, we're going to have copies of your resume. If we're doing our jobs right, we're probably either going to have them on screen or on paper in front of us when we're talking to you. And we're going to ask questions about the stuff on your resume. And if you don't know what we're talking about, make trivial lies about the stuff from your resume that we're asking you about, or otherwise just flunk this, then A, you flunk, you're gone, but also, this is the kind of crap that led me to spend all of y'all's time this afternoon talking about this, right? This is an avoidable mistake. If you didn't go to the college, don't put it on your resume. If you served in the military, but you were never deployed overseas, don't say that you have combat theater experience. I'm pretty sure that's actually a federal crime, so that's another reason not to do that. What's that law?
Stolen valor.
There we go, thank you.
Just out of curiosity, I mean, how much, what kind of percentage, so you've interviewed 10 people, what percentage of those 10 people would you say is going to lie or this statement? I'm just out of curiosity.
Careful. 75 plus.
It's human nature.
It depends on the round, right? So, like, of all the people who submit to a job listing at some big company, I mean, the computers try and filter some of that stuff out, and HR tries to deal with it before it gets to us. In terms of, like, resumes I've been in contact with, painful conference calls I've been on, it's not that often that I catch somebody outright lying, though that does happen. The lesser mistake, but still pretty bad here, is you put this stuff on your resume. That's a to-do list of things for me to ask you about so that you can sound cool. If you put something on there and I ask you about it and you don't know what it is, you don't sound cool. And if I ask you about something and I ask some kind of leading question, like say I use a version number, and you don't know that that's not a valid version number for whatever you put on your resume, right? Like if you hacksawed the Pentagon with Cali 5, I'm totally gonna ask you how you did that and where you got Cali 5.
Hacksawed the guys at Cali, he got Cali 5.
Because I want a copy, and also because you're lying on your resume. Backtrack did make it to 5. Cali's on 2016.2, and if you were on IRC this week, you know where I'm at with that. Don't lie on your resume, especially not in ways that's easy for people to catch. Don't lie involving the interview process. Don't lie on the phone. It might be recorded. Don't lie in email. It's discoverable. Basically, I'm telling you not to lie. If you get far enough along in this process, you will either get to talk to a hiring manager or you'll have a round of interviews with managers or leader types. I don't know what happens in these meetings. I know some of the kinds of stuff they ask from like debriefing people and asking them about it, but there's gotta be some secret sauce here. And fill in some Dilbert jokes. Yes, sir. Oh, sorry, seeing somebody more important. Got it.
Thank you. Here on the
But some of the kinds of stuff that managers are probably going to ask you, kind of like I'm giving you hints about the direction my questions are going in, but I'm not necessarily telling you what the questions are, except maybe the Cali one. This thing right here and this thing right here are incredibly important as you're working to build a team. You know, we talk about like an individual's fit for a position or like could I be some use to that team or that company, but managers, if they're good at their job, are trying to plan ahead in time. So they're not just trying to get somebody who can do work for them to help solve their problems, 30 days from when you're talking. That would be great. But what they really need is somebody who's probably going to hang around for a few years, who's going to help solve problems they don't know they even have. Whoop. Got one loose. Oh, I know, it's pretty cool.
He's really
close. Stew.
It's better that way. Turn him in at the end of the weekend.
Brunswick stew. Okay.
All right. You can influence how this part of the discussion goes tremendously if you're prepared for it, and back to knowing what you want. If you're trying to get a fully remote job as a pen tester or a malware analyst or something, you need to be able to sell yourself as someone who can work independently and get stuff done, rather than a lazy ass who never does any work and doesn't come into the office. And then, like, budgets and how much flexibility they have in salary negotiations and whatever else it is managers spend their time on. Whew, all right. Is this me?
Yes.
So finally, here are my recommendations, and these apply to anybody at every level, though they're certainly awesome for people who are just trying to break in. To help your skills and career, to make your interviews suck less, to have a happier life, I don't ever sell it too much, read a bunch of stuff, participate in the community, go that way. Write some stuff, whatever you can. Ask for help when you need it, and a little bit of self-knowledge. Read security news. Not only so you'll actually know what's going on, but because, okay, it's a giveaway, we ask about this in interviews. Try and stay up to date with either general security news, big attacks, trends, new kinds of tools, new operating systems and their vulnerabilities. What did Cisco do wrong this week? Why is Juniper still a thing? Oh, right. I should have worn my Sun Tzu shirt. Sorry. And then as you find stuff that interests you, or if you have a defined specialty or field, you know, obviously keep up with that field online, but you know, follow links. Chase stuff down, not only to help you in interviews, but also just to make you a better, more rounded person and to like learn a thing.
Yes, I'm that old.
Oops. Oh. And read job listings. I used to have a whole slide about this, but I compressed it down. Read job listings for your field and maybe for fields next year's. Read job listings, of course, for the jobs you're trying to get, but read job listings for jobs you don't have any prayer of getting, just to see what they're asking for and what they think you have to have. I mean, if you're putting together a career path where, you know, you're trying to get hired as an analyst now, but you know you want to grow up to be an engineer, well, read the engineer job descriptions. Find out what they think an engineer is, and then let me know. And it will give you some hints about some of the other stuff that we talk about here, as far as like college or certifications. Are you raising your finger?
Yeah. Also, the other thing I found is read your own company's job descriptions, the jobs you have.
Yes! Fantastic point. Oh,
this is a bunch of fluff.
Read the job description for the job you already have to see what they think you're doing, both while you're still doing it and as you look to make a move, because if you put that on your resume and you go try and get a job somewhere else, they're going to go read that public job description. And if it has nothing whatsoever to do with what you actually did there, you need to be prepared to handle that in interviews and in communications. And hopefully in a positive way, right? Even if it's a negative situation, even if it's awful and that's why you're quitting, nobody wants to hear about that. Especially not in the context of a business discussion about whether or not you're going to be a good fit for their team, right? If you get hired, or if you make friends, and you meet up at a bar later, and you want to tell them the real story, that's between you guys. And maybe you'll get an opportunity to do that. But don't bring that into the discussion. If you don't have anything good to say about your current position, that can be a little bit awkward, but try and stay silent, like your mom told you.
How do you deal with job listings that are basically bullshit,
though? Oh, they're all bullshit. Having written a couple. Anybody else written a job rec?
But I mean like super bullshit. Like,
are
like jobs that ask for a C, yeah, jobs that ask for a CSSP but have less than 2 years.
And have literally nothing to do with any kind of management
CISSP
position at all.
For entry level position.
Thank you.
10 years of study experience.
10 years in the 1990s sometime, I don't exactly remember when, I was getting phone calls for senior Java developer. And they wanted 5 years of experience.
Now, 95.
Yeah, so I was running the betas of Java in 94 or 95. By the time they were giving me these calls, it had been about 2 years. It had maybe been GM, like 1.0, really rough, not really useful for anything except that jackhammer applet. Hopefully none of you get that joke.
Heck, I was building for AOL back when they were in the heyday.
So we'll touch on this a little bit more in a couple more slides, but this is absolutely a big point. And the answer, though it doesn't help you directly, is that the people who wrote that job rec, or the people who edited it, have no idea what those words mean. None whatsoever. They just copied and pasted some stuff from somewhere. Hopefully that somewhere was an email from the hiring manager, but that doesn't tend to often be the case. It seems to be kind of a rare situation where you actually get to write your job recs for the people you're trying to hire, and HR just takes them and posts them and doesn't give you any back talk, or like run them through some kind of word filter that makes everything more moronic. But we'll talk about the certifications thing here in a second, because that's important.
Can I ask you another quick question?
Yeah.
So I had a headhunter call me yesterday. She couldn't even pronounce half the things that are basic requirements. And I was like, and then she goes, oh, you're not qualified. And I'm like, actually, you're not qualified to interview me, but I didn't say it.
Yeah, so...
It's usually true.
I don't touch on recruiters or robocalls in here, but I think you have the gist of it. Try and stay polite.
Oh yeah.
You know, if they're like breaking federal law by calling you, you can politely let them know that before you hang up on them.
The main problem was how to get past this idiot who doesn't know anything to the hiring manager.
Yes. And sometimes you actually have to, because there is a job past that gate that you do want. Certifications are one of the shortcuts past some of those gates. But there are others. Nepotism still being the most popular. Sometimes effective, but be careful. There are only certain jobs where committing a felony to get the job is a positive thing, especially if you get caught. Only certain jobs.
I don't think you have a choice on that type of job.
Well, there are the kinds of jobs you get recruited for involuntarily, but I don't spend any time talking about those up here. Remember up front where I said if you don't think law and the understanding of law code is important?
Don't talk to the police.
Don't talk to the police and don't speed. Or break any other laws. Yeah. That's one way to get yourself hypothetically recruited involuntarily, I've heard. So beyond reading cool stuff and learning, get involved in the community. And this is actually something you can put on your resume, but even beyond that, actually being involved in the community, even at a very low level, can be tremendously helpful when you're trying to differentiate yourself from a pack of other candidates. If you're trying to get an intro-level position, all of you have the same ridiculous undergraduate degree, but one of you has actually talked at local hacker groups and it was well received, that's gonna help you out. And there are amazing online resources for this stuff now.
I would say it's also kind of like pseudo, because like I've never seen, very few talks have I ever seen not be well received. Like, if you're willing to stand up in front of a bunch of people, that's a huge hurdle to pass.
So, no lie. Being dumb or brave enough to come up here and start talking, that's, for your first few times, that's the hardest part. Planning, preparing slides, trying to think of what you're going to say ahead of time, these are all great. I recommend them. I'm working on them all. But I just wanted to point out that just being a member of the group and not contributing in any way that anybody else can document, probably still a good idea. I mean, throw some money in the tip jar, not gonna turn that down, but in terms of actually helping you out, you need to do something that gets you some recognition. So whether it's getting on with actual, you know, technology or security associated groups, but even if you're just in community orgs and volunteering and have a positive relationship with people, and even a rep, in a volunteer community or a charity. I mean, I want to switch topics here, but if you do cool things with your church group, that's legit fodder for talking about how you are a good communicator, you have good social skills, you show up on time, which, as we talked about before the presentation, is a hugely important factor. So go to groups. Thanks everybody for showing up. Join online groups, discussion groups. One thing that you can do with almost no knowledge about anything is help out in the support channel or support mailing list for almost any open source software project. Any cool tool that you hear us smart sounding people talk about, Security Onion, Kali, Wireshark, any flavor of Linux, CentOS, Gentoo, whatever, all of these have online communities where newbies come by every hour of the day asking dumb questions, but asking them honestly and needing help. You can build a reputation for yourself online just by basically being customer service for a community like that. And whether you can actually put that on your resume depends on like the resume format and who you're submitting it to, but you can still talk it up. You can still make that a part of your portfolio. And again, this is a way to differentiate yourself from other candidates who might have the same education or the same complete lack of documentable professional security experience. There's all kinds of online challenges that you can do. Some of them are even competitions with prizes. I mean, if you win some of this stuff, obviously that's going to help you out a bunch. But even if you compete, if you try, you'll probably learn some things. But again, also, this is something that you can list, that you can talk about, and you'll meet people. And if you're crazy enough, you can present at local groups or conferences. We've always got slots open at DC404. You guys certainly don't want to see me up here more than once a year, I'm pretty sure. B-Sides is freaking amazing. I went to B-Sides Augusta last weekend, and it was one of the coolest conferences I've ever been to. And I got in free, which is great. But even if I had to pay a few hundred bucks to get in, it still would have been awesome. I paid to get into the Security Onion Conference, and they had a deal where, yeah. I wasn't speaking at B-Sides this past weekend, though I know some folks who did. Did you have a question? Or?
Yeah, is B-Sides Atlantic really dead, or what's the deal?
It happens. It doesn't seem like we get a lot of warning before it happens.
It's just randomly in your face, hey, it's here!
It's pretty drafty, I guess.
And a lot of times it's been on weekdays, which has pretty much been a no-go for me. Like, one time I was actually working downtown, and we're like, hey, B-Sides is in like 3 weeks, and it's four blocks from here. And there are even still tickets available, but it was like on a Thursday. I had a bunch of meetings scheduled. I mean,
or the breakfast ones are really bad too.
Okay. So was that?
Actually, the body
breakfast
ones.
They did not have good food. Is that what you're saying?
No, getting there on a weekday.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Having a meeting on a weekday during office hours downtown is tough. I think one of the things that made B-Sides Augusta so successful is Saturday. At a university campus, so it wasn't completely idle, but we mostly had the place to ourselves.
So,
sure.
So in terms of meetings, between DC404 and 770 and the 2600?
So those are the hacker groups in Atlanta, but there are plenty of like more legit-seeming professional groups for pretty much every aspect of information security, or just technology, right? Like, if you hack in a language, like if you're a .NET developer, or hack on Java, God help you, there's actually a pretty vibrant community in Atlanta of people who do that, and who are willing to come out in public and admit it by gathering in a place.
There's also a good Atlanta
Mainstream. Yeah, AIL is fantastic, and the Atlanta Macintosh Users Group is still going pretty strong, I think. One of the great things about a big, messy, traffic-infested city like Atlanta is that we have the opportunity to have a lot of communities like that that you wouldn't necessarily find in a smaller place. So you can take advantage of that if you're in or anywhere near Atlanta. But these don't have to be information security specific, right? It's great if they are and if you're into that. But even if you just get to know people at a developer meetup or a DBA meetup or project management. I mean, they even have things for like people who want to be CISOs. If that is your career goal, then start going to meetings. They can transition you over to the other meetings later. Whatever it is that you're working on, whatever it is that you're learning, please write about it, at least for yourself. And if possible, just publish that to the internet, kind of thoughtlessly. It's really great practice. Writing this stuff down will help you learn it better. Learning to communicate online is incredibly important, especially if you're ever going to get a job doing anything these days. And you might actually find some people who are trying to learn the same thing, and you help them out, and vice versa. Even if you don't feel comfortable posting this stuff to the public, just blogging it and never showing it to anybody, or posting GIST. Is it GIST or GIST? That was actually a joke for someone who isn't here, apparently.
What,
sir?
What blogging platform do you recommend?
I'm sorry, what?
What blogging platform do you recommend?
Well, they all suck, so. Because it's software, I'm a sysadmin, all software sucks. Your favorite operating system is crap.
No, Arch is the best.
Ooh, wow. So, it's kind of a separate talk, but honestly, if you're just getting started, WordPress.com is not the worst answer.
That's just self-hosting, right?
Well, I mean, it's WordPress.com will host it for you. You get limited options as to what kind of crazy stuff you can do with it. On the other hand, you don't have to be a server sysadmin for an internet-connected system that's constantly under attack.
I'm pretty sure.
So unless you're into that.
Unless you pay money, they actually technically own all the content.
Okay. That's something to watch out for, certainly. If you have any kind of hosting already, which I don't think that's a thing that people do anymore, but it used to be common in my day, and I still do.
Yes, I recommend you use your own hosting so you don't have to then give them all your content legally.
Yeah. Certainly. And the other option, of course, is GitHub or one of their competitors. I find, did we say it's Gist?
Gist.
I find Gist increasingly handy for just slamming some crap into Markdown and leaving it someplace that I can find later. Compared to like, hey, this is code that I should check in somewhere because somebody else might ever want to use it, right? There's a pretty big difference between those things. But either way, keep the stuff. And if you are really new to learning about hacking or learning about computers, I swear to God, use a paper notebook. Okay. Buy one that you like that has a cool design on its cover. If you want to get a Trapper Keeper, that's fine, whatever. Hopefully, no. That's not a thing anymore, right?
It's still out there.
I think it came back and then went away again. Maybe.
You can find it at the dollar store.
You can always burn paper.
Well, yes, paper is destructible, but more importantly, when you're really new and you're learning about the power of things like, I don't know, F-disk? All those great notes that you took that you didn't want to post yet because you're not brave enough, that were on the laptop that you were learning on, that you just destroyed the file system of irrevocably. This is why we say use a paper notebook. And write down anything that seems like it might have been useful. Certainly, if it took you more than 20 minutes to figure out or look up online, write it down locally until you get a better idea about what's actually worth taking notes on. You can grow out of the paper notebook once you get a handle on things. You set up your own lab. You learn how not to destroy machines when you don't mean to, or possibly how to forensically recover data, if you're into that. And finally, and most philosophically, the more that you know about yourself, the better that you're going to be at this process. And this is one of the things that applies the most to people who aren't quite so new anymore, right? As you're taking that second or third hop, as you're thinking, hey, I've been working for people for 10 years, this freelance thing, this startup thing sounds cool. Well, there are resources for helping you learn more about whether or not that's the right answer for you. But even before reading up on the topic, knowing what you actually can and can't do, knowing what you want, and sometimes more importantly, what you don't want, hugely, hugely important. And you might get asked these questions in an interview. You might not necessarily want to fully answer them. But again, knowing the answer is incredibly important. So in the negative requirements section, which is possibly the most fun, I'm standing here as a SANS instructor, telling you don't need SANS. Our classes are great. You will learn a ton. Arguably, you can't possibly learn enough on your own in a week compared to what we can teach you in a week because of the amount of preparation and QA and editing and testing that goes into it all. Yes, sir. Yes.
I'm just very cocky.
We set priorities at the beginning of the talk. It's fine. So, flat out, I have a great time teaching classes and make a little money on the side teaching for SANS. Full disclosure, take classes from SANS or from another fine company if you can afford it and if it will help you. You don't necessarily need those classes to learn things, of course. You have to be able to learn on your own anyway. If you haven't figured that out yet, that's your first task. You don't need the certifications, except for a really very few specific jobs that you actually do need them for. And honestly, for most of those, if we want you, we'll get you in and get you the paperwork afterwards. It's not as much of a barrier as it looks like, except maybe for government contracts. It's about the only place that I've seen where it really is a hard requirement. Similarly, in a lot of those, you have to have some kind of ongoing relationship with the government, some kind of colored badge or something.
Clearance.
Yeah, that. if you actually have that sort of thing, then you can go for those jobs. In some of those situations, if you don't, they can help you get it, but you need to understand what those requirements are. That doesn't apply to most people. Almost anybody working in corporate or small or medium-sized business doesn't have to worry about that. It's really only if you're working for the government or doing contracting for somebody who works for the government. Perhaps even more controversially than saying you don't need any security certifications to get a job in the security business, and on camera, apparently. God help me.
Yeah. Don't take me podcasted.
You don't need college. You certainly don't need grad school. Probably. It depends. A baccalaureate program from any accredited liberal arts institution will have given you the opportunity to learn how to learn, to learn how to research things you don't already know, and, I'm not kidding, how to write papers. If you learned anything else from your undergrad, consider yourself lucky. If you learned other things but you didn't pick up any of that from your undergrad, you should probably try and get a refund. And good luck. You might have to settle for never giving the Alumni Society a dime. They won't stop asking, by the way.
I have an art degree and I work for Blue Team, so.
Some of the most awesome analysts and attackers, blue and red, are people with undergraduate degrees in art or history. Some of the most amazing and skilled reverse engineers and just like wizard hackers in terms of like device hacking and stuff that we all read about in the news. Some of them didn't even finish high school. They just, there was work for them to do. They got started doing it and they made a career out of it. Now I'm not saying that's the easy path, far from it, but it is there. So to your question earlier, when you see these kinds of things in a job listing, they may think of them as requirements, and you should be understanding of their beliefs, as you should always be understanding of other people's beliefs. But don't look at them as a hard barrier, because they aren't usually. And if you can work your portfolio, your network connections, your awesomeness to get in touch with that hiring manager, or even a technical contact on that team to show that you are actually worth talking to, then we can get past a lot of this stuff. In my experience, it hasn't been an issue. Full disclosure, I mentioned I teach for SANS. Those are essentially graduate level information security classes, 4,000 level, 5,000 level. Maybe someday I'll teach a 6,000 level class for them. I don't actually have a bachelor's degree. I can't go to grad school with SANS because I don't have a bachelor's degree, and that's like the one thing that you have to have before you can go to grad school. So it's absolutely possible. It is harder, certainly. But it's absolutely possible. And on that note, having said all the nice things, let's take a moment and talk about undergraduate degrees in InfoSec. Well, there are undergraduate degrees in IT, where you learn things about like computer operating systems and how networks function and, I don't know, databases or maybe some scripting or light programming stuff. Based on my earlier statements about what you should be learning from an undergraduate degree, if you get a bachelor's degree in anything and you didn't come out of it learning how to research, learning how to teach yourself, and learning how to communicate on paper and hopefully other ways, then it doesn't matter what the rest of the stuff was. So if you take a BS or a BB or whatever and they teach you Perl or Visual Basic and get you your Cisco certs, maybe, sure. It almost doesn't matter. You need to learn how to learn. And you should be able to get that from a good baccalaureate program. Or just figure it out on your own, like a bunch of the rest of us had to. And then, stuff like IP network subnet addressing and assembly language code and AppSec stuff is all stuff you're going to learn yourself. You're going to teach yourself that stuff, possibly with the help of talented instructors like us at the SANS Institute. But seriously, you're going to be teaching yourself. That's pretty much my comment about an undergraduate degree in InfoSec. I don't really believe in them. But honestly, a lot of the master's programs aren't much better.
Yeah. Oh, one thing about undergrad degrees. It's not so much about...
it's not so much about what you do as it is who you do it with, because those people that you do it with will probably be the people who are managers or high-level people in 5 years if you get you the job you want.
Absolutely. So here's the thing that I don't really know very well because I didn't finish college. The education stuff, you know, that's like on the brochures and the seals and like the things that happen in class are important and are part of the reason that you're there. But a huge part of the college experience is the social experience, working in teams, working in groups, getting to know people, starting your professional network. No kidding, most successful people started their professional network in college, possibly with an organization that used Greek letters in its name. Nothing I can do about that. So that's a huge point. And in fact, that's actually true for me. While I was flunking out of some of the best engineering schools in this state, I learned how IPv4 worked, I learned how to set up an ISP, and I learned how to compile a Linux kernel. And we passed around the video for Spirit of Christmas, and now South Park is 20 years old. So it wasn't all good. Understanding what you're trying to get out of something, whether it's a job interview, an online course, a book you're reading, or certainly a multi-year degree program that you're thinking about picking up and paying, or borrowing tens of thousands of dollars for, please, please, please understand what you expect to get out of it and what your chances are of actually getting it, right? If your chances are better at the tables in Vegas, well, I hear that's fun. You'll at least be done faster.
You go through that 30 grand class.
Probably, depending on which tables, but probably. So you don't have to be working in information security to get a job in information security, though gosh, it sure helps. You don't have to actually be a hacker or be elite or spell things funny. In fact, that's kind of a negative in professional communications, like when you're trying to get a job, you know. And you don't need to have any kind of hat or any color of hat. You don't need to be a black hat, a red hat, brown hat, gray hat, whatever.
I was gonna say we're not a fedora.
Speaking as a Debian bigot, no comment. Cool, how are we doing? All right. So that is the bulk of the presentation. Does anybody have any immediate questions about any of the stuff that I slung up there?
Can a visitor say something?
Sure.
Okay, my initials are DAD.
Yes. This is my father, in case anybody's not keeping up with the terrible jokes.
And one of the things that you need to learn is to learn to be able to test the validity of information.
Hmm?
And my students aren't getting that.
Yeah. So my dad has been through a few careers. He actually did something that we'll refer to as information security work for the government in the 20th century. That's vague enough, right? More recently, he actually teaches college. So he's kind of seeing this from both sides, right? When he was in his teens or 20s, he was dealing with young recruits who were trying to do crypto stuff under unfortunate conditions. There is no such agency. I don't know what you're talking about.
No such agency.
And now he's trying to deal with the undergraduate students who aren't necessarily picking up the essentials. Especially, he's taught a lot of speech classes, like Rhetoric 101, what's it, Com 1201?
Now Speech Communication 1500.
Wow, the number keeps going up. Does that mean it's better?
No. No, but it's a skill and you need it.
So, absolutely. Speaking from the blue team side, you know, we were joking about this a little bit earlier before we started. Like, the number one thing that I need an analyst to be able to tell me is I don't know. I can't answer the question. I don't know what this data means. I don't know if this alert is valid. I don't know if this person's lying to me. And then immediately followed up by, but here's how we can find out, right? And one of the big differences between like analyst to engineer to architect to me is where you are on that spectrum, where your instincts are, how quickly you can design and execute an experiment to find out what's actually going on, and experience, frankly.
I don't know who the sender is.
Yeah, or
big time.
The this is what the headers say, but I don't trust them because the crypto's not good. That would be a snippet from my how to read emails talk, which I still haven't quite put together. But it's a surprisingly complicated and intuitive process that a lot of us execute very, very quickly, and maybe you haven't thought about how hard it is to actually teach to someone. Trust me, it's hard to look at a set of mail headers and go, Google, Microsoft, SPF, that was signed, Yahoo. Okay, yeah, that probably came from them, and yeah, there's a bunch of links in this, but none of them look evil, right? Like, I do that in like 60 or 90 seconds multiple times a day.
Who the hell is Bill Clinton?
But trying to figure out how to explain that is pretty tricky, and the more that you understand about your own cognitive processes, and the more that you are able to classify the trustworthiness of the data and then do something about it, blue team, red team, purely working in intelligence, even in a civilian capacity, it's incredibly important. And it is something that you should learn in college, and honestly, it's something that I think the youngest generation is getting a head start on a lot of the rest of us, because they are so exposed to all of the public networks and all of this data from a very young age that, unlike some of us at my age and even like the generation after mine, the youngest generation, the people who I think are dismissively referred to as millennials, actually have better filters and change their filters faster and more accurately than we do. And I think that's going to make them great analysts and great attackers if we could just get them to actually show up for a phone call on time. Does anybody have any stories they want to share? I don't think any of the worst interview stories that provoked the presentation are here in the room, but I could be wrong.
One suggestion I would give as somebody who interviews a lot of candidates is actually talk with people about whatever it is you're interviewing with, because I run into a lot of people who read lots of it and they talk on forum, type on forum all the time, but they trip up themselves actually talking and in phone interviews and in-person interviews, and you kind of break the barrier.
Yes, and a kind of a freebie as part of that. Learn how other people pronounce some of these words. I gotta tell you, if somebody gets on a call trying to get a Linux sysadmin position and they don't pronounce it Linux, I'm an understanding and compassionate person, but that puts us off on the wrong foot, right?
You're doing it wrong. It's Linux. You're doing it wrong. It's Linux.
So it might be, but once upon a time there was actually an AU file on kernel.org that was a recording of Linus pronouncing it. So that's what I'm trying to go off of.
Later saying that his name is pronounced Linus, however the operating system can be pronounced any way that's proper in your locale.
Sure, and also he likes GPLv2 because it's less restrictive and he doesn't care.
But he hates Java though.
Well, doesn't everybody?
Yeah.
But very, very good point. Having good book learning on a subject, but never having spoken out loud over voice channels or, you know, in person in meet space with other people, especially other people who are knowledgeable about it, that will show through in a job interview, especially because there's a lot of pressure in those situations. So you can make that easier on yourself by practicing. One of the ways to do that, of course, is by volunteering to stand up here and talk about something. A couple of three meetings ago, we had a big roundtable discussion for like, I don't know, 6 hours about the future of DC404 and what kind of presentations we wanted to have and the meeting format. And one of the things that we wanted to stick to most of the time, and this one's a little bit of an exception, but I think we're gonna get started, everybody talking more here in a second, is to encourage everybody who is remotely willing to stand up for 5 or 10 minutes and talk about what they're hacking on and what they're learning this month. And if nobody else is interested in it, if nobody asks any questions, well, it doesn't hurt much. You sit down, the next person goes. If two other people are hacking on the same thing, they're learning the same thing, you guys can exchange questions. Maybe there's a whole thing going on. The three of you can go get another table, exchange contact information, and now you have allies. Now you have people who can help you learn a thing. Now you have hopefully people whose mistakes you can learn from so that you don't have to repeat them. I believe you were next, sir.
I was going to mention that if you're here, you have peers. We are your peers.
Yes.
So don't be afraid to, if you're going to go for an interview or you're looking at something or you're writing up a resume, ask your peers to review it.
Absolutely. On IRC, certainly, here in person, and a little more carefully on the mailing list. Absolutely. I wouldn't send your resume out to the mailing list unprovoked.
Well, maybe just take your email address and your home address.
But if you wanted to say, hey, would anybody like to look over my resume before I interview with some companies next month? And if anybody responds and wants to, then hopefully they're not a troll. If they are, you'll learn something about the internet. So, you know, it's not a total bunch.
Wait, two.
So, absolutely. And this is a great group. Has anybody figured out the NB crazy running joke throughout the whole slides?
Not well.
Some of the most ridiculous ideas on a lot of the bullet lists?
And for a newbie, it would be crazy.
That is true, but sadly, that's not the punchline. Anybody?
NB is not well.
Well, not the Bene, sure.
Not the Bene.
It's all stuff you put.
Yes! That was my path.
What?
That was my path, right?
Everything he said was crazy.
The crazy last bullet on a lot of these slides is the way that I did these things, right? I'm not recommending that you do it, but it did work for me, and it could work for you. You've got lots of options there, and absolutely use the community. So the reason I brought that joke up there, it's too bad Keith's not with us. I mentioned in part that I got an IT job at SecureWorks, and that was where I was able to actually switch over to be full-time in security. Well, I got that IT job at SecureWorks because Keith posted to the DC404 list that they were looking for people, right? So this is closing the loop for me. But besides the personal aspect of it, I think it's a very real thing that you can take advantage of. And DC404 is a great group for that. Atlanta's a pretty great town for InfoSec, if you didn't already know. But the mailing list and the group here, when we actually do leave the house, I'm more guilty of not doing that than some. A lot of you folks actually show up pretty regularly, which is awesome. Let's see what else we got. Yeah, okay. Anybody else have anything remotely related to stuff on slides to share, questions?
I would be happy to share with kind of what I'm hacking on with others that are interested. If anyone's doing some like VoIP stuff, there's a very well-known PBX that's using sold like hotcakes. It has an interesting remote phone application that is getting its pants hacked off. It can't patch the PBX. It's
cool.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. So we're.
Do you wanna take 10 minutes here after I wrap up here in a second?
However you want, but I'd be curious to see what others are working on and if you're doing anything with SBCs, session board controllers, VoIP. I'm Gregory, by the way. Nice to meet you.
Okay, so. Greg's first up after we close out Careers Day here in a second. I do have one more thing I want to do besides the slides, but I'll everybody help me remember. That one? His name's Gregory?
No pressure.
Hey, you gave out your name, man. It's not my fault. I mean, that's the name you're giving us. If that's not your name, then, you know, cheers.
You didn't learn any different slides.
So here's some books and blogs. With a lot more stuff about InfoSec careers, a lot more resources. Leslie's series, Hacks for Pancakes, is incredibly detailed and awesome. She goes into a lot of detail about how to succeed at security conferences, including DEF CON. She talks about home lab setup. A lot of folks talk about that. I can do a whole talk about that, so I'm not today. The slides themselves, including this one, for you poor folks who are trying to phone cam it, are online already at my site, at AdricNet, linked off the front page. Brian Krebs, who you all may know as the person who told your company that they've been breached. We have a fond relationship with him at my day job. We should have him by sometime, I swear. Just, like, have a dinner in his honor or something. And Daniel Miesler has a fantastic write-up and a bunch of other cool blog posts too if you haven't seen him yet. And then this is the link to the Breakin presentation and all this stuff. All right, so, group, who has a job at InfoSec? Nice, that's a pretty good mix. Okay, hands down. Who is looking for a job at InfoSec? Cool, okay, that's good on the self-knowledge thing. You don't wanna be surprised by that fact. Whose company, and or possibly themselves, if you're your own company, are hiring for an InfoSec or security-related position right now? Well, I mean, not here at the meeting.
We're always looking.
always hiring for IT people.
Okay, I mean, that's valid. I mean, it worked for me, right? You can get in the door with IT, use your security knowledge to work your way in. It's a popular and frequently very successful plan, and honestly, it gets us some of the best blue team people because they know the environment and they know their way around systems.
So I get hit up on LinkedIn from recruiters. So like Verizon is hiring for vulnerability management person, so I can share that information.
Sure. You want to send it out to the list? Sure. A lot of people do that. If you get recruiter spam that doesn't seem to be completely stupid, you can send it on to the DC404 list. There's also, I believe, a specific listserv for Atlanta InfoSec jobs that I don't remember the name of off the top of my head, but we can find a link to you. And we mentioned the Atlanta Linux Enthusiasts, the AL group. They have a jobs list separately, AL-jobs, which is actually really great. There's some really good recruiters who work that list, who actually know a little bit about Linux and the community and are actually trying to help people find good jobs. So not all headhunters are assassin droids.
I think I posted this to the list, but I heard that MailChimp is hiring a pen tester. So
they've been hiring a pen tester for like 8 months.
Yeah.
I applied once, they didn't bother replying, and then I applied another position. I'm like, you should apply to our pen testing. I did, they never responded.
So a more advanced topic is how to navigate big companies, right? As we talked about a little bit, the person who wrote the job rec, the people who actually answer the web page, all of the fine folks in HR who are involved in the process in various ways, they don't necessarily know what the words mean. And plus everybody, mostly everybody, is human, right? People can make mistakes. If you haven't heard back from somebody, and you're still interested in the job, especially if you actually had a human on the line, it wasn't just like putting a form in, you know, give them another ping.
Well, so I actually eventually got a response, but then, please fill in your available time in this web form, which I did. Then there was never a follow-up from that ever.
Sure, and for me, it's worked better to talk to people
right. And
then get HR and stupid forms involved. I was joking with a buddy of mine at work the other day about the generic application, right? Like, where did you go to high school?
Yeah.
And like, what felonies have you been convicted of? and personal references, right? Because they always ask for those on that form, but never before that in my experience. And the last two or three times I had to fill that thing out, it was either after they'd already given me a job offer or because they were trying to get it into some computer system so that they could send me an offer letter, right? We were that far along in the process. Obviously, the HR person didn't need any of that garbage to offer me a job. They said they needed it to actually like give me the job, and maybe that's true. But understanding little niggles like that can happen. It will definitely work better in almost every situation if you've gone in on a diagonal or sideways. So the guy that I'm working for now, I actually met him on an information security mailing list. He posted like an open call that he was looking for folks and kind of like what they were up to, and I replied to him on email, and he's like, yeah, we should talk. And we talked on the phone a couple of times, and then you know he handed me off to HR and found me an engineering position. That works pretty well, and it gets around a lot of the machinery of HR, which is primarily designed, this is not a negative thing, to keep people from getting jobs. Or at least to keep them from having to look at so many applications. Especially for entry-level stuff, they get thousands and thousands of applications. So a little bit of persistence, a little bit of patience are helpful. Not to your personal anecdote, but I think just generally. There are a lot of companies around Atlanta that are hiring, or that say they are, which is another thing that you run into. Some of these specialties are so hard to find someone for, that with organizations that put up with it, we will leave a rec open as long as we can get away with. Even if we don't actually want anybody right now for that whatever senior position, just so that we have a lure in the water, we will leave that one listed. And if anybody calls, we will talk to them. And if they're great enough, we'll try and make a hole. But that doesn't mean that there's like an immediate need, especially for a more technical position or a more senior position. On the other end of it, for the entry level stuff, you've got competition, probably a lot of competition for any of those positions. So patience and perseverance, being well set up in terms of having your portfolio together, and honestly, you know, side doors. Network with people, find people who know someone at the organization, even if it's just a casual acquaintance, you know the person well, being able to just ping them and say, hey, I applied for this, I'm still really interested. Can you, you know, go wake up HR? We'll work wonders. And we'll get you past a lot of this human foibles, bad computer code stuff that might otherwise keep you from the job that you want. So absolutely a great point. And as to the names of the organizations that are hiring in the area, if nobody wants to stand up here and say that's cool, almost all of them are, at least for IT, and most of us are hiring for security. Not necessarily for the job that you want, or maybe not at the pay that you were expecting, but we are absolutely looking for people. We were so desperate for people in our security operations center that we actually pulled in some 6-month contract hires from an agency because they could help us vet people quickly and get them on site in a couple of weeks. Whereas if we have to look through hundreds and hundreds of candidates trying to find people for a level one position and then actually hire them on full time, it's much more expensive and slower, and that way we were able to get people faster. We're going to try and get both of those people, because they've been really great, on as full time. Anybody hiring? Anybody have any other stories?
How job posts can be this wish list, basically, posted by HR. And for example, we take a look at this one on my phone.
Oh, take, what you got?
Yeah, this is pretty ridiculous for what it is.
Wow. What is this listed as? Like a help desk tag?
Entry level desktop. And look at all these markets.
Wow. I think it's entry level desktop support with significant VoIP and ESX experience. They basically want like a DevOps network engineer for their level one help desk. I mean, hey, if you can get it, they're going to be probably really bad at that, honestly.
I said the least number of requirements for our senior was EA was hiring a right underneath the CIO, kind of like a VP, CISO kind of role.
Yep.
And it was 5 to 10 years of experience, CSSP, PowerPoint.
That's really all you need, though, right? I'm like, that's really all you need. I direct you.
Business communication and technical ass kissing are incredibly important in a C-level executive. Yes. Understanding their role in the organization and being able to communicate. I mean, you don't want them analyzing packets. Yeah. You probably don't want them writing code. Not any CISO I've ever worked with.
So Joel, now I've actually had to teach a recruiter how to use PowerPoint. Like, how do I add a new slide? Like, it's ridiculous.
Okay. But if you're able to do that, you might make a friend. Or at least a friendly acquaintance. It is a little ridiculous, but you know. Not everybody is as good at their job as you want to be at yours. If they were, speaking from a blue team perspective, we wouldn't be so busy.
Maybe that's a good thing.
I mean, there is the whole idea of job security, but it doesn't need any help right now. As we move towards this internet of crappy things. Yeah, people make projections like that. That kind of takes us back to that C word and some other things that I pretty much debunked or strongly disagreed with in the presentation about like what the requirements actually are for the job. And you know, I didn't really get into like what does it actually take to attack or defend a network and why.
There are plenty of videos out there on that.
Well, sure, but moreover, what I will say controversially, and then try and give up the stage, is most of what affects me in being able to defend an organization is IT being sucky.
Yeah.
If they were doing a better job, if they were fully funded, because I don't mean to blame people in IT, it's not usually their fault. If they were actually staffed by the business, it wouldn't be as big a mess. It wouldn't be as hard to find things. There wouldn't be as many places for attackers to hide. And when bad things do happen, you know, there'd be stuff like backups and, you know, documentation and other stuff. This is particularly painful for me because I work in incident response. So pretty much I'm only there when things have already gone completely pear-shaped and everybody knows it. Otherwise, it's just threat hunting and it pays better. A little bit, okay.
I was going to say, you know, like I think it's not just IT being understaffed and underfunded, though, and you know, it's also like at least, you know, I come from mostly a much smaller company background, so like, you know, anywhere from 10 to 200 employees. And like, a lot of times, IT and SecOps don't have a real seat at the table at that point. You know, like the company is so small that you might have, you know, an IT guy who's like, we're not supposed to deploy, you know, mail.app or whatever. Like, we need all this other stuff. And the CIO or the CTO or whoever walks over and they're like, I gotta get this email. Like, you know.
and the realities of businesses and the decisions that business leaders make affect us all.
Yeah.
And I don't want to take too strong a position in that, because I think it's more nuanced than it's usually treated.
So in my company, my boss CIO reports to the CEO, which is like direct conflict of interest. Fairly soon.
So there's some really interesting discussions going on, especially if you talk to some auditors or some compliance people about how that could work or how that should work, depending on what your compliance regime is or how senior you are. The idea of conflicts of interest within an organization's core organization is a huge thing. But my slightly less political and more sciencey point there is, if you look at something like a list of security problems or a list of common vulnerabilities, or if you use the 20 common controls developed by the Center for Internet Security with help from a lot of people, including SANS, there's 20 of them. Incident response, that's me, is 19. And they're prioritized, right? The first couple are, do you know what devices you have on your network? That's CC1.
Probably important.
And CC2, do you know what applications are running on those devices?
Also probably important.
And to a greater or lesser degree, every organization I've worked with has struggled with some of that stuff. And then it goes on from there, right? The CCs, although they are descriptive of security problems, they essentially represent infrastructure problems, and not just technology infrastructure, right? There's a lot of business infrastructure and process infrastructure that's missing, like having disaster recovery plans and business continuity plans and actually giving people vacation and all kinds of stuff. All right, so I'm going to shut up here if nobody has anything else to say about InfoSec careers. And I'm actually going to leave the room for a second, which will help me shut up. I believe Gregory is the name he's using today. Excellent. Wanted to talk about, was it VoIP? And anyway, what are you hacking on, man? Come on.
So we're hacking on some VoIP stuff.
I'm going to introduce myself quickly.
So I hope you guys are enjoying Manuel's Tavern. The wireless is really fast. If it's not, then it's my fault. So please come to me if you see anything out of order. We did the wireless, the voice telephony here, as well as the network, separated networks for the point of sale, credit card, DCI compliant networks. So that's us. So we're hacking on a big problem with remote extensions that we don't know where they're coming from. VoIP is kind of a big target. Everybody wants to make free calls, especially but there's a lot of toll fraud. So if say you've got a smaller PBX or Asterix or BroadSoft, those can be a little larger. You know, how do you filter those requests? You can hit these things with 1,000 requests for access a second almost. They can overwhelm it, crash it, and the thing has to reboot, all phones go down. So we're thinking of putting something in place like a conduit that the remote phone would connect to this conduit, and then that conduit would be a trusted IP to the PBX of the server. So that's kind of our software security, software as a solution or security as a service piece that we're gonna roll out or develop. So if any of you guys have ideas or worked around VoIP, no offense to the women in the room, VoIP is really chatty. If you've ever seen it on Wireshark, there's lots of packets going back and forth. We're very latency sensitive, so those are things that we have to take into account. We don't want an on-prem solution just because for customers it can be a little difficult. And they don't tend to be very, there's for smaller businesses, so sub 200 heads. But so if that's anything you're interested in or you want to chat more about VoIP, feel free to see me. This is my buddy David back there. We do and user support for small businesses as well. So he's my counterpart. So if I get hit by a bus, he's the guy that will take my place. Very important. The more you learn, the more you become very important. Very well established places like manuals, and you want to make sure everything just runs very smoothly. I'm going to be starting a MakerTik user group here in Atlanta. I don't know if, how many people know MakerTik. Is there a few? Awesome. Okay. If you don't know about MakerTik, it's really cool stuff. It's kind of like a Cisco on steroids. That's maybe 1/15th or 1/20th the price. I got a bunch of them if you want to borrow one. Be happy to help you out. So, any hands of anybody's questions or interested?
Have you looked into deploying TLS? Like SIP over TLS?
I haven't played with that. That's a possibility. I try to stay away from the encryption stuff just because
those that are
the
terrible.
I mean, we don't have to deal with, I mean, you have CIA and NSA there, but on the carrier networks, they tend to wrap things well, and we want those flags to be displayed. So if we encrypt things or use VPN, that adds latency and overhead.
Yeah.
So as much as I'd love to do it, it's kind of a little more tough, but I'd be open to it.
Yeah. I mean, I think you can just do your signaling over TLS, and then you can probably do RTP,
Anybody else?
I would just ask anybody in the group that is working with VoIP, just if you are always looking for better tools and tool chains and kits to be able to diagnose the issues. So if anybody is like a SIP expert, feel free, we'd love to hear from you, because it is just a nightmare to find the problem in the stack.
Anyone else have anything else to add? Or?
So this conduit you're talking about, you're going to put something like a fraction between the filter?
So the conduit, so we have a couple, there's something called Camellia that's really popular that you put in front of things like Asterix. There's this other piece called Fraphos. I've never heard of the thing, but it seems pretty interesting. I think it kind of does that. So we're playing with, we're going to start playing with Fraphos and AWS. I use a lot of Linode stuff. Anybody know Linode here? Anybody knows Linode? You know Linode. It's awesome. Not that AWS isn't. It's VoIP is really latency sensitive, and Linode is just a fantastic network. So we really enjoyed their Dallas location. It's the telecom headquarters, so it just seems to work really well for us. So those are the two kind of conduits that we're thinking of right now. All right. Did anyone else want to talk about something they're hacking on, or
we've got something?
Connor, come on up.
Quick question. How about contacting you?
I say again.
How do I contact you?
Find me after this. I'll be happy to give you my mail.
Cool.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Good to see you.
Thanks. All right. Did any of you guys see that post that I did to the talk about the PI Zero?
Yeah.
Okay. Who got one?
Yeah,
you should go get one. Now, I can't confirm this, but I hear that they're going to end the sale today or tomorrow. So if you want to get one, it's 99 cents right now.
I know a guy named Bob who may have acquired some stuff to make fireworks with. So if you would like it, just see me and we get some security. It's not a ton, but I mean, apparently they're legal. They're legal now in the U.S., but I don't know how it is about ordering the bits to make it. Because before you could make flash powder, you could order like one bit from here and one bit from there, but you couldn't order both bits. So I wasn't really into it. I just acquired it from somebody else. So and there's also bottles outside. It smells a little warm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oops, sorry.
We're not. While I'm recording, we're not live.
Okay.
But I'll get the stats.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm not taking any credit for this. I literally was just told by my coworker, hey, you should go get a Pi Zero, and here's why. So, So I've got two of mine. I'm going to pass them around if you guys want to like quickly look at them. Scott, do you mind plugging this into your computer real quick?
Really? You're
not
really
do it?
Not really.
Okay. So, the person that actually kind of developed this little fun thing was Moovix. He posted this link out there for the Land Turtle and for the USB Army. So, And then when I heard about it, that someone was talking about, oh, we just did this port over to the Pi Zero. So here's the URL so you can go and pull the write-ups. I'll post this to the talk later on today. And it all hinges on Responder. So props to the guys over at Spider Labs for developing a Responder. So for what we played with, we needed a couple of things. We needed a target computer that we could attack. We needed a device, basically a USB little mini computer. And then there was some confusion on whether or not you needed an OTG cable. The answer is yes, only for initial setup. The only reason you need that is somehow on these devices, you've got to get a working Ethernet or working interface up so you can remote into it. Outside of that, no, you do not need an OTG cable to attack. So I've actually been using a little, like a $2 just power cable with data from Amazon. So that's what I've been using, and I was able to successfully attack a couple of my coworkers' computers. So now we've only been playing with this for 2-3 days. So this is something that is very fresh. But it's fun when you got a computer, you're sitting there walking around the office like, oh, here, let me plug that in. And we actually got one of my coworkers, we walked up to him and said, hey, we need to plug this in, see if this works. He plugged it in. And then we started to say, oh, hey, look at your device manager. Oh, it's showing up as a Ethernet driver. Okay, let's go look at the IP of this. And then he said, oh, wait, you guys know more. Here, how about you let me
start driving.
So he let us drive. So, and he's in IT, so,
yeah.
Yes.
He's such a nice guy.
He's such a nice guy.
Appreciate it.
So we went and we pulled up the information, and lo and behold, hey, in the database was his hash, his domain name, and his hash, and it gave a timestamp. So to give you a little information about what it's actually doing is Responder is basically setting up a DNS, DHCP server, and it's essentially creating an SMB share. And it's plugged into your computer. It said, hey, I'm an Ethernet device. Oh, hey, by the way, I'm an SMB share, so I need credentials. And then your computer, which most computers are trusting of the network, go, oh, okay, here's my credentials. Passes it in hash, and then it just collects it.
Using the SMB.
Using the SMB, yes.
You just try to connect to it with PC. So
it's a locked workstation is the real pleasure.
Well, it's on a locked workstation, yes. It's the computer must be logged in, but locked.
Yeah.
And okay. One, or it actually doesn't have to be locked. You can be logged in.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, but if
even
you spot
if
it, yeah, other venues, but to be able to walk up to a locked computer that somebody's not sitting at, that's
that's the key.
Because we've tried the SME all the time. Anyway.
Yeah. Well, it actually, when you plug in a USB device into your computer, there's actually like a whitelisting of sorts inside your computer that says, okay, all these devices we're going to allow, all these devices we're not going to allow. One of the devices on that list is network adapters. So it actually, while the computer is locked, and you plug in a USB device, it says, oh, this is a network adapter. Okay, we'll just allow it and we'll let it run and
everything.
So, this literally is the entire little device set up for hacking. We were actually talking about how can we make this a little bit more hidden, user-friendly or such, and what we came up with is go get a Western Digital drive and crack it open, put this in the Western Digital drive, and then just put in a USB adapter on the inside, and then hey, here, plug in this this Western Digital drive. There's some files on there. They're like, oh, it doesn't see it because they're not looking at the network adapters. They're looking at something else. Like, oh, I don't see it as a drive. Oh, it must be not working. I got another one in my backpack. I'll go get that one. And then you pull out your other Western Digital drive and you hand it. So
yeah, where are the remediations?
Can you disable SMB?
I saw that they patched Windows 10, but it still works.
Yeah, they tried to patch Windows 10.
Oh, is this only Windows 10?
No, actually,
should be everything.
This, the last one, the Joseph, he actually went through and he tested on like five different distros of Linux, two different versions of Mac, and Windows XP all the way up to Windows 10. And he's got confirmed working. We've tested it only on Windows 8, 8.1, and 10 so far. So we're still working. We're waiting for a couple people that have Macs that walk away. One of our users has a UBP, and we're trying to convince him that we just need to swap out. But yep.
Did you disable and show off this entire floor?
Because it's easier to spawn or which is a shit.
Well, if you like survey around the room,
though. I don't know. I worked with him on some of this stuff, so. Right now, we're just playing with it. I mean, it's something fun. And the whole reason that I'm up here kind of talking to you guys is, hey, it's 99 cents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe there may be a group policy to prevent new network adapters, but I have to double check that.
Possibly. There are some mitigations.
You didn't think at all?
Lockdown environments. It should help with that. Yeah, it's going to get almost everybody.
Currently. So,
this might lead to some more epoxy and USB ports.
Yes. What was the tool that someone showed us to lock down USB ports?
Oh, with Lindy makes it.
Lindy,
it looks
yeah.
Like a thumb drive.
It's basically Lindy is a little adapter that basically has a bunch of these. You plug them into the computer and pop off the adapter, and
oh,
you just leave something.
Plug it into a port.
Yeah, jam it into the port, and you can pull it in and out. So.
You can just like 3D print one of those things. Like there must be a CAD thing somewhere that's like this is exactly the size of a USB.
So right now what we're talking about is physical mitigation. Okay.
I mean, depending on your attack surface and what kind of machines you're talking about. For the day job, we'd be able to do something about this for corporate, but maybe not for all the public locations that we have to support.
Well, we were sitting there talking about, oh, what if you walk into like a coffee shop and they just happen to have a USB port sitting there right in front of the right behind the register, and plug that in, and get something. Or you walk into like a library. A library has a couple of nice computers sitting there unlocked, and they got a USB port. So
Even if you build a company for some meeting, whatever reason.
Company for some meeting and the secretary walks away.
Nobody asks you who you are, you just
And it literally, it took about 20 seconds for my device to actually register something that it did. So 20 seconds of plug in to live to pull out, and then I've got...
Maybe the TV shows come true, man. That's not cool.
I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't even watch any of them. I have cable, but I don't watch cable.
There are magic devices on some of the written TV shows where they walk up to a computer and they're like, oh, okay, got it.
So,
very cool.
Yeah, that's what I've got for show and tell right now. We're still working on just playing around, testing with it, see what we can get into it. And then we have a hash. And we're in talks on creating a hashcat server. Actually trying to break one, but that's a different topic or a different time.
What is it? It's like some big ass computer in like 3 months or like...
Yeah.
I think it's like 8K on Amazon
or
something like that.
Yeah.
So if you
want
to
for an NTLM?
Yeah.
Or no.
Yeah.
NTH.
Yeah.
I mean, it's doable.
It's doable. Yeah. I mean, it's a hash. So.
Well, I mean, they're still unsalted, right? So you might just be able to look up.
Yeah,
they are unsalted.
So. I don't know if they have a rainbow table program set up yet.
They're very, very big.
Yeah, rainbow tables are...
Well, there's a project through Boink that's a distributed system that you can take your Boink-enabled machine and contribute to that allows you to contribute to the generation of rainbow tables for all kinds of cool shit. And they're freely downloadable.
You got Boink the link for that?
Not off the top of my head, but yeah, I can do that.
Just post it to the talk player.
Boink's like a screensaver thing, right?
It's
kind of like that old...
World Community Grid is what I use. Yeah. And Boink is the underlying software that makes it work. Basically, it allows your computer to log in to become a distributed processor for... a virtual supercomputer.
Okay.
And you pick projects that you want to contribute to, and as those projects have work and your machine has cycles, your machine downloads work, and you know, from the system, it does the work and then sends back the results. The system maintains, I believe it's triple redundancy, so that way your results are verified against at least two others for validity, to make sure that you're not having, having some crazy stuff with the results. And it's, you know, they're doing stuff like mapping cancer markers in the genome and all kinds of crazy stuff. Very interesting.
Well, that's it for what I'm working on. We're still kind of playing around with it. Wait, you're giving me more props than him?
Yeah. He didn't ask for it.